out there that got 2, 3, 4, and 5 saviors, which one done it?
That's right.
All right. Now let me work on the throne of God. Amen. Let's get Bible what heaven is. And then give me the book of Luke, the throne of David.
Mm.
I want to explain this. Now, viewers, let me educate you and teach you. When you read throne in the Bible,
yes,
when it talks about God, let us remember throne is not just narrowed down to chair.
That's right.
When you're carnal minded, you think a throne is just a chair.
That's right.
That somebody sit upon. But if you focus on the language of the Bible,
amen,
a throne is bigger than a chair when you're touching God.
Isaiah chapter 66, we'll start at verse 1.
Notice what the Bible says.
Isaiah chapter 66, and we're at the first verse.
And then, I believe, give me the book of Ephesians, how Jesus ascended above all heavens.
Yes.
And then I want to pose a question to my viewers.
Mm.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Come on, son.
Isaiah chapter 66
and
verse
1. You know, one thing I know about the Bible that make you think deeper than you ever thought before.
Oh, yes.
All right, hear this.
Thus saith the Lord.
Thus saith the Lord.
The heaven is my throne.
The heaven
is my throne.
The heaven.
The heaven is my throne.
Singular. The heaven
is my throne.
Is my throne.
And the earth.
And the earth
is my footstool.
All right. Let's go to school today. If I take that literally, anyone here don't know what a footstool is? A footstool is something that you rest your feet on. Now, who in the world think that the Lord,
amen,
sitting in heaven, legs protruding through the clouds, and his feet resting with his legs crossed on the planet Earth?
That's right. That's right.
Let me take you to school. Do you mind going to school tonight?
Amen.
If you do mind, I'm going to take you anyway. Let me give you some historical knowledge. In the study of Egyptology, you often heard me say, the writing of the Egyptians, their alphabet wasn't like ours, like of today. They used symbols, pictures, things of that nature, leaving an accurate history of their existence. It was called hieroglyphics. There are spiritual hieroglyphics in the Bible. And if you don't know what these symbols, images, mean, you'll take it literally. Let me make an example. The scripture says God is a sun, S-U-N. We all know the sun is that which is created that brings light to the earth. So when the Bible says God is a S-U-N, a sun, find out the function of the sun, then you will find out how God functions. What does the sun do to the earth? Bring us light. Wake up planets or plants when it's asleep. That'll show you the characteristics of God. He brings light in our life of darkness and wake us up to his word when we are spiritually asleep.
That's right.
Are you listening?
That's right.
The Bible also called God the husbandman. Do you know what husbandry is?
Yeah.
One that plants seed so crop can grow. God plant his word, for the book says the seed is the word. So his crop, his church, can grow. For he said, those plants that my heavenly father have not planted shall be rooted up. Are you listening?
That's right.
So in the Bible talking symbolic forms, if you take many of those things literal, look at what the Bible called God, Rose of Sharon. God is no rose. But what does a rose do? It smells good and it hurts you. It smells good, but it has thorns on it. It'll prick you. God is a sweet smelling savior.
Oh, yes.
But with that same word, it'll prick your heart.
Prick your heart.
Just as the thorns do on the stem of a rose.
That's right.
Do you get me?
That's right.
Glory to God.
Isaiah 66 and verse 1.
What is it?
Thus saith the Lord.
Thus saith the Lord.
The heaven is my throne.
The heaven is my throne.
And the earth is my footstool.
Now, you have to look at heaven bigger than a chair, because the Bible talks about Jesus, that he ascended
up far above all heavens.
Listen at this.
In the book of Ephesians chapter 4, and we're at verse 10.
What is it?
He that descended.
Uh-oh. Ain't no flesh and blood descended.
No.
Ain't no little baby came down from heaven, flesh and blood, or no grown man came down from heaven, flesh and blood.
No.
Got him married, then shrunk to a baby, grew back up to a man, come out, and then grew up to a man again.
No.
That didn't happen.
No. That's right.
Somebody said the begotten Son of God was in the beginning. You need to go to school and look up the word begotten in the dictionary.
Right.
When a thing is begotten, it's conceived.
That's right.
Who was a mother to a begotten son?
Right.
In the beginning. There was no women in the beginning.
No.
So who begot Jesus?
That's it.
Nobody.
Nobody.
Jesus' very first nature was not human.
No.
Christ's first nature was divine.
That's right.
For it was the Spirit of Christ that was in the prophets.
That's right.
Telling us beforehand about the suffering of Christ. Spirit wasn't going to suffer.
No.
The flesh of him was going to suffer.
That's it.
Give me the book of Peter.
Now the book of 1 Peter.
All right, son. Follow me in your Bible.
Amen.
I want to take my time and itemize this.
Itemize it, Pastor.
All right, come on, son. Let me say it.
1 Peter chapter 1 and we're at verse 10.
Real quick.
Of which salvation the prophets have inquired.
Focus on the language of the scriptures.
1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 10.
Of which salvation the prophets have inquired.
And search diligently.
Search diligently.
Who prophesied of the grace that should come unto
Searching
you.
Searching what?
Or what manner of time.
Or what manner of time.
The Spirit of Christ.
Listen, the Spirit of Christ,
which was in them,
and the one the Spirit was in were the prophets. What did it do?
Or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, which was in them, did signify?
It did signify.
When it testified beforehand.
When it testified, the Spirit of Christ testified beforehand.
The sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow.
Same title, different function.
That's right.
Spirit of prophecy and suffering.
That's right.
The Spirit don't suffer.
No.
Spirit don't bleed.
No.
Spirit can't die. Spirit don't shed blood.
That's
Spirit
right.
Spirit is not born.
That's right.
And the Spirit of God is not related to nobody.
Nobody.
Mary is not the mother of eternity.
No.
That's Catholicism.
That's right.
Which Mary, the mother of God, God ain't never have no mommy.
No.
God is without mother.
Without mother.
And without father.
That's right.
Without descent, without beginning of days, no end of life. That's God.
That's God.
All right, go back to where you were, son.
Searching what or what manner
chapter
of time?
And verse.
1 Peter chapter 1,
yes.
Verse 11. Searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ,
Spirit of
was,
Christ
in them,
was in them
did signify.
Did signify.
When it testified beforehand the sufferings
the
of Christ.
Of Christ. Go back
glory,
to where you were.
I was in Ephesians chapter 4 and at verse 10.
Let's have it.
He that descended. Is the same also that ascended.
What did he do?
Up far above all heaven.
All right. Now, what part of heaven is his throne? If he ascended far above all heavens.
All heavens.
And he's higher. The Bible talk about in the book of Job.
Yes.
He's higher than heaven. Imagine that. Deeper than hell. Broader than the sea.
Longer than the earth.
And is longer than the earth. What part of heaven can hold God?
That's right.
Yet the Bible says heaven
is
his throne.
And earth is my footstool.
And earth is his footstool and is longer than the earth.
That's right. Canst thou by searching find out God?
Glory to God. I want you viewers to get this.
In Job chapter 11 and at verse 7.
You know, when you try to analyze God with your carnal mind, you use logic to try to explain him.
Yeah.
But listen at the Bible.
Job chapter 11, we'll start at verse 6.
Says what?
And that he would show these things, the secrets of wisdom.
Yes.
That they are
wait,
double.
Wait.
And he would
do
show
what?
Thee.
He would show thee.
The secrets of wisdom.
You see, when you talk about God, that's secret wisdom.
That's right.
And God will show it. He will show it to whomsoever he wants to have it.
And that
that's why men is all mixed up today. Two gods, three gods, four gods. They don't know the secret of God's wisdom.
That's right.
God haven't showed it to them.
That's right.
And thank God the thing was so deep until it's written. When he was here in the flesh, he says, if they have known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Thank God, but they had no clue.
That's right.
Who they was dealing with.
And that he would show thee the secrets of wisdom.
He would show thee the secrets of wisdom.
That they are double to them which is.
They are what?
That they are double to that which
is. They are double to them that which is.
Know therefore that God exacteth of thee.
Yes.
Less than thy iniquity deserveth.
Yes.
Canst thou by searching find out God?
Hear me, viewers. Can you, by searching,
find out God?
Find out God.
Canst thou find out the Almighty unto perfection?
Can you find out the Almighty to perfection, which means can you completely understand the Lord?
It is as high as heaven.
It is
as high as heaven.
As high as heaven.
What canst thou do?
What can you do about it?
Deeper than hell.
And hell is a bottomless pit.
Deeper
than
hell.
And it's deeper than that.
What canst thou know?
What can you know?
The measure thereof is longer than the earth.
Longer than the earth.
And broader than the sea.
Hell is broader than the sea.
If he cut off or shut up.
If he cut you off.
Or shut up.
Or shut you up.
Or gather together.
Or gather you together.
Then who can hinder him?
That's what I like to know. Who can stop him?
That's right.
So in the Bible talk about this throne. He appeared to apostles and prophets sitting on the throne.
On the throne.
But he's higher than that.
Higher. That's right.
Give me Revelation 4:1.
Revelation 4:1.
And then we'll get the first chapter of the book of Luke so we can properly explain what is David's throne.
Revelation chapter 4, we'll start at verse 1.
Every good news.
Revelation chapter 4, we'll start at the very first verse.
Follow me.
After this I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven.
Oh, here. A door
was opened in heaven.
What is that, Pastor Jennings? Jesus opened up.
That's it.
That's it.
But the Bible said a door opened up, Pastor Jennings. That's right.
Right.
But Jesus said,
I am the door. In St. John chapter 10 and verse 9.
Huh? You see what I mean by harmonizing the Bible?
That's right.
The Bible says a door was opened up in heaven, and give chapter and verse what Jesus said.
St. John chapter 10 and at verse 9.
Who did Jesus tell us he is?
I am the door.
What?
I am the door.
Why do he call himself the door? If you want to know what's on the other side, the thing got to be open.
Right.
When Jesus opened up himself, he explained himself.
That's it.
Eh?
That's
he
right.
Opened himself up, made himself known. He manifests himself.
That's right.
Amen. That's why when he opened the apostles' understanding, you can hear the door slowly open up, and that's why they can preach him without error.
That's right.
When a man try to make Jesus the second or third person in the Godhead, the door haven't yet opened up for him, so he's shut out.
That's right.
Glory to God. What is that?
I am the door.
I am
the door.
Not we are.
I am the door.
I am the door.
By me.
By us.
By me.
By they.
By me.
By me.
If any man enter in.
If any man enter in.
He shall be saved.
He shall be what?
He shall be saved.
Now, how many saviors we got? Because God is the Savior.
That's right.
And Jesus is the Savior. God saved before he was manifest in the flesh. He saved Noah and his whole house. Eight was saved by water.
By water.
What you gonna tell me? Jesus didn't save them?
Mm.
During the time of Noah, he was spirit.
That's right.
During the time of the apostles, the spirit manifests himself in the flesh.
That's right.
During the time of the church, he's best spirit. That's why he's called is. Was
and is.
And is.
And
is spirit, was flesh, is spirit again.
Again.
Glory to God.
That's right.
I hope you can get this.
That's it.
come on, son.
I am the door.
I am the door.
By me.
Glory to God, by me.
If any man enter in.
If any man enter in.
He shall be saved.
Oh, you can't. You will be saved.
He shall go and shall go in and out.
He shall go in and out.
And find pasture.
And listen, I'm going in and out of Jesus.
That's right.
I'm going in and out of Jesus.
That's right.
He said you'll go in and out.
In and out.
That's too deep for the current of mine.
Oh, yes.
Amen. I know because I go in and out of Jesus.
In and out.
I go in and out.
That's right.
Amen. The church is to go in and out of him.
That's right.
You walk with him, thank God, and when you go out and you go to yourself, you're still with him.
That's right.
Huh?
That's right.
That's why it's called a comforter. Well, you don't need comfort when you're surrounded, you're comforted by people. You need a comforter, thank God, when nobody's around. You need God help by yourself.
That's right.
Then Jesus step in and be the comforter to you.
That's it. Back in Revelation chapter 4 and verse 1.
Come on, son.
After this I looked and behold.
And behold,
a door was opened in heaven.
Yes.
And the first voice.
You see,
which
this is what I mean by not just reading it, but dissecting it. Form an autopsy with the Bible.
That's right.
Cut it open and see how the inside of the organs work here.
After this I looked.
After this I looked.
And behold, a door was opened
Jesus
in heaven.
Jesus opened up in heaven.
And the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me.
It sounded like a trumpet. Notice he didn't say it was a trumpet. As it were, a trumpet. That was the voice of God.
That's right.
Come on, son.
And said, which said, come up hither.
Come up hither.
And I will show thee things which must be hereafter.
No, we'll show you.
And I will show thee things which must be hereafter.
You multiple God believers, you're just as blind as a brick.
That's right.
Everything we look at here is one.
I will show thee things.
I will show you.
Which must be hereafter.
All right.
And immediately I was in the spirit.
That's what's missing in the pulpits.
That's it. That's right.
That's what's missing in the pulpits of America.
And immediately I was in the spirit.
You got men hollering, yelling, screaming, but what are they missing?
I was in the spirit.
The body without the spirit is dead.
He's dead.
That man can holler all he want, scream all he want, until he get hoarse. But what does he need?
I was in the spirit.
Don't you hear Jesus tell his apostles? It's not you that's speaking.
That's right.
But the voice of my Father
that speaketh in you.
Speaketh in you. Amen. That's what's bringing all these people here, everywhere around the world. Hey, Pastor Jennings.
No.
It's the voice of my Father.
That's right.
That speak within us. Thank God many ain't never heard God's voice before. So God used my voice and then speak through me that bring you to God. That's what God do.
That's right.
God used the voice of the preacher, and the people never heard God's voice. So God stands in the preacher and allow the world to hear
hallelujah.
God through the preacher. And God,
hallelujah.
And God draw the four corners hallelujah. Of the earth unto him through the preacher.
That's it.
As God speak through him.
That's it. And immediately.
So if you want to know why these folk are running to Pastor Jennings, man, they ain't running to me. They're running to Jesus.
That's it. That's right.
Amen. They're running to Jesus.
That's right.
Come on, son.
And immediately I was in the spirit.
What?
Immediately I was in the spirit.
I want the spirit.
That's it. That's it.
I want the spirit.
The spirit.
Let's get a broader understanding of the spirit, what being in the spirit is. Some think being in the spirit is just when you jump and shout, you can jump all around the church. No, no, no. Jesus said the words.
Words that I
that
speak,
I speak unto you.
They are spirit.
They are spirit.
And they are life.
And then what he said?
In St. John chapter 6 and verse 63.
If someone don't get their foot up in 5 years, but they live by the word, he or she is in the spirit.
That's right.
Somebody can be jumping all over the church and not in no spirit at all.
St. John chapter 6 and verse 63.
Thank God. This is why this the truth of God broadcast. Stay in the scriptures. We stay in the spirit.
That's right.
Huh?
That's right.
Amen. We stay in the spirit, and I refuse to get out the spirit because I have confidence in everything the spirit says, because there's no lies in the spirit.
That's right.
And there's no self-made opinions that's given by the spirit.
That's right.
Everything the spirit says is true and facts.
That's right.
That's why we stay in the Bible.
That's it.
And nobody can get us out the Bible.
That's right. St. John chapter 6 and verse 63.
Amen. Come on, son.
It is the spirit that quickeneth.
Uh-oh. It's the spirit that wake you up.
The flesh profiteth nothing.
Uh-oh. You got preachers and people out there hollering now. Pastor Jennings said you can't compliment or credit the Son of God for nothing. That's right. That's what I preach.
That's what you preach.
On his own, he didn't do nothing.
No.
Listen at me loud.
That's right.
Jesus, the Son of God, didn't do one thing on his own.
No.
He said so.
That's right. It is the Spirit that quickens.
He said so. I do nothing.
Of myself.
Nothing.
That's right.
I say what the Spirit says.
St. John 14 and verse 10.
Let's get Bible.
St. John 14 and verse 10.
I preach Jesus on his own. The Son of the living God could not do one thing on his own.
That's right.
That's what I preach.
That's right.
Now, what are you going to do about it?
Amen.
Huh? Come on, preachers. Come on, churchgoers. Jump, holler, and scream, and moonwalk like Michael Jackson and scream like James Brown. But Pastor Jennings preached to the world. Jesus,
that's right,
the Son of the living God, you can't name one thing that he done on his own.
That's right.
Now, let's see if I'm talking what he taught.
St. John chapter 14 at verse 10.
Glory
first.
To God.
St. John chapter 14 and at verse 10.
Oh,
first.
I love this. Come on, Satan.
Believest thou not that I am in the Father?
Do you believe it?
And the Father in me?
Hold it. I am in the Father.
And the Father,
and the Father in me. What do you mean? I'm in God's will, and God's will is in me.
That's right.
I'm in God's will. How is that, Jesus? To fulfill the prophets. God's will is in me. How is that, Jesus? I got to die.
That's right.
Come on, son.
Believest thou not that I am in the Father?
I am in the Father.
And the Father in me.
And the Father in me.
The words that I speak unto you.
The words that I speak unto you.
I speak not of myself.
I speak not of myself.
But the Father that dwelleth in me.
But the Father that dwelleth in me.
He doeth the works.
He what?
He doeth the works. Now in St. John chapter 8 and verse 28.
He always referred you to the Spirit.
That's right.
Always.
And that I do nothing of myself.
Here, chapter and verse.
St. John chapter 8 and verse 28.
Here.
And that I do nothing.
I do nothing.
Of myself.
Nothing. Nothing.
I do nothing of myself.
I didn't walk on water on my own.
I do nothing of myself.
I didn't turn water into wine on my own.
I do nothing of myself.
I didn't raise Lazarus from the dead on my own.
I do nothing of myself.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. I didn't preach on my own.
I do nothing of myself. Nothing.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
God, when I was up on the mountain and Moses and Elisha appeared.
That's right.
I didn't cause my body to glisten on my own.
I do nothing.
No.
That's right. I do nothing of myself.
I didn't cause that dove to come down from heaven and light upon me.
I
didn't cause that voice to say, this is my beloved son, and hold my world, please.
I didn't do that. Of myself.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Why didn't I do it? Because his body represents the church, which is the body of Christ, and we cannot do nothing on our own.
That's right. That's right.
Am I right, I said?
Hallelujah.
Jesus said,
and that I do nothing of myself.
Give chapter and verse again.
St. John chapter 8 and read verse 28.
I what?
I do nothing of myself.
What about preaching?
Nothing of myself.
Teaching.
I do nothing of myself.
Baptizing my disciples.
I do nothing of myself.
Turn water into wine.
I do nothing of myself.
Signs and wonders.
I do nothing of myself.
Raise the dead.
I do nothing of myself.
Fed the 5,000.
I do nothing of myself.
Break bread.
I do nothing of myself.
Coming back from the dead.
I do nothing of myself.
Glorifying our body.
I do nothing of myself.
Appear unto his apostles.
I do nothing of myself.
Hallelujah.
I do nothing of myself.
Oh,
Nothing.
He wanted to teach the world.
That's right.
Don't credit his flesh.
I do nothing of myself.
Credit the Spirit.
That's right.
He wants the church to know you can't credit yourself.
That's right.
You got to credit the Spirit that's in the church.
That's right. I do nothing of myself.
That's what's bringing all these souls.
That's right.
The Spirit is bringing them. That's what's pricking these thousands of people's heart. The Spirit is doing it.
That's right.
That's what's making them be baptized. The Spirit is doing it.
That's right. I do nothing of myself.
Glory to God when someone get up and testify. God killed me of cancer.
Hallelujah.
Spirit has done it.
That's right.
Somebody else testified. I was blind, but now I see.
That's right.
Spirit.
That's right.
Spirit doing it.
That's right.
Somebody else testified. I had a tumor. Thank God, but they can't find it no more.
That's right.
Spirit, hallelujah. Yes.
That's right.
Spirit, Lord.
I do nothing of myself.
That's why you got to have a Spirit-filled church.
That's right.
If the church without the Spirit is dead, that's why you got to have the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Got to have the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
We're seeking the Spirit.
That's it.
That's why you folk that are watching.
That's right.
Hundreds of people wrote us, received the Holy Ghost while they're watching the program.
That's right.
They thought the Spirit is in it.
That's it.
Watching it on the internet, Spirit come out that computer.
That's
and
right.
Fill them with the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
What?
Hallelujah.
Spirit, that's
Hallelujah.
It.
Hallelujah.
When they listen at the radio,
Hallelujah.
Thank God to receive the Holy Ghost.
Go ahead.
While I'm sitting there listening,
go ahead.
Thank God the Spirit comes.
That's it.
And I come through speaking in tongues.
Hallelujah.
Because the Spirit is in it.
That's it.
The body without
the Spirit, is dead.
Is dead.
Being alone.
The church of the Lord Jesus Christ, you can't be the church without the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
Let the preachers yell. Let them holler. Without the anointing.
That's it.
Of the Almighty God.
That's right.
There ain't no sheep coming.
No sheep coming.
There will be a few stragglers here and there.
Hmm.
Somebody that like you.
Yeah.
But Jesus said, my sheep.
My sheep will hear my voice.
Hey, hallelujah.
My sheep will hear my
voice. My sheep. Look, hear my voice.
And a stranger.
They hear it.
You will not follow.
Hallelujah to God. They hear it. Glory to God. When I get testimony out of Australia. Amen. They wrote me a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
Amen. From Japan. Said they won't go to no church. They decided to take the program and put it on their social media.
Yeah.
They said we're going to watch your program until you come to Japan and build a church.
That's right.
Because I want to be saved.
That's right.
They contacted us from Vietnam and said we're meeting in the hut.
Go ahead.
Please send somebody there to baptize us.
Go ahead.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Go ahead.
Why? They hear God's voice.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yes, sir. What? They hear God's voice.
Hallelujah.
And
that's
God.
It. That's it.
My sheep.
My sheep will hear my voice.
My sheep.
Glory hear to my God. Voice.
Yeah, glory to God. My and sheep
will hear my voice.
Hear my
and
voice.
A stranger.
And a stranger.
Will they not follow?
How do you claim to be God's sheep and follow a stranger? If you got sheep, you won't even fellowship with a stranger.
That's right. That's right.
Jesus said, my sheep
will hear my voice.
My sheep, my followers.
That's right.
We are his followers.
That's right. And when
we'll hear
my voice.
My voice.
And when he putteth forth his own sheep.
What did he say?
In St. John chapter 10 and at verse 4.
Glory to God.
And when he putteth forth his own sheep.
When he putteth forth, hallelujah.
His own sheep.
His own sheep.
He goeth before them.
He go before them.
And the sheep follow him.
And the sheep follow.
For they know his voice.
Hallelujah. Do you understand?
That's it.
They know it.
And God's sheep know God's voice.
For they know his voice.
It'll quicken, hallelujah.
That's right.
It'll quicken their soul.
That's right.
I don't care if they stay out of church. For 3 years.
Amen.
Or 5 years. Amen. If it's God's sheep.
That's it.
Sitting at home. Sitting at the radio.
That's right.
When they turn on the program.
That's right.
That God is in. the sheep can identify
and the sheep follow him. That's right.
Thank God, why go down to the soul.
That's right.
And preach the heart of God's sheep.
Okay.
And the sheep cry out, Abba Father.
That's right. And the sheep follow him.
The sheep follow him.
For they know his voice.
They what?
They know his voice.
They fight it.
They know his voice.
They fight his voice.
They know his voice.
They speak against his voice.
They know his voice.
They reject his voice.
They know his voice. And a stranger will they not follow.
Suppose the stranger is your brother.
And a stranger will they not follow.
Is your father.
Will not follow.
Is your friend.
A stranger will they not
is
follow.
Is your best friend.
Will not follow.
Is your deacon.
A stranger will they not follow. But will flee from him.
Do what?
Will flee from him.
Fellowship with him.
Will flee from him.
Or get far away from a stranger.
For they know not the voice of strangers.
Hallelujah to
Hallelujah.
God. The reason why folk run after strangers.
Hallelujah.
Stranger preached Acts 2:38.
That's right.
Stranger preached Acts 2:4.
Right.
I'm not happy or glad or so overwhelmed or glad to see you, stranger. I don't tell no false prophet I'm glad to see you.
No.
I'm not a liar.
No.
I shake a false prophet hand. How you doing? I don't tell you I'm glad to see you because I'm not. Unless you're obeying what's written here.
That's right.
Yes, sir. That's right.
I never tell a false prophet, I'm glad to see you.
That's right.
I don't do that.
No.
Amen. Unless you want to obey the Bible, I'm glad of that.
Right.
Amen. Otherwise than that, he said, my sheep
will hear my voice.
I'm not a friend to no false prophet in the world.
That's right.
I refuse to be that. Many people write me, well, this false prophet talking about you, that false prophet talking about you, why you never call some their name? Listen, there's so many false prophets out here, I don't even care that many exist.
That's right.
I'm not interested in their name. They really don't mean anything to me. I'm busy. I'm preoccupied.
Busy.
Fishing.
That's
right. I'm sitting on the banks of creation.
That's right.
Fishing.
That's right.
Huh? Amen.
That's right.
I'm not just fishing in America.
No,
I'm not an American fisherman.
Amen.
Amen. We fish in Canada.
That's right.
Amen. The glory to God. We fish in China and Japan. Yeah. And Cuba and Puerto Rico and Australia and New Zealand and Scotland and Ireland and Honolulu, thank God, and Vietnam and amen, Africa and every continent I'm fishing.
Go ye into all the world.
I'm sitting on the banks of creation, kicking my legs and fishing with Bible.
That's right.
And every time we fish with Bible, God bear me witness, I never come out with an empty rod.
That's right.
Huh?
That's right.
Not once.
That's right.
Glory to God, we come out with the rod is full. Amen. When we drag that fish to shore, amen, there'd be so many at one time all the time.
That's right.
This is the Lord's doing.
That's right.
He said, I do nothing.
Of myself.
Give chapter and verse again.
Back in St. John chapter 8 and verse 28.
So, yeah, dude, that's criticizing me and said, Pastor Jennings said, the Son of God can't credit him for nothing on his own. That's right.
I do nothing of myself.
He said it. So
he
I said it.
That's right.
You name one thing that he done on his own. I dare you to name one thing.
Then said Jesus unto them.
Then said Jesus unto them.
When ye have lifted up the Son of Man.
When ye shall lift up the Son of Man.
Then shall ye know that I am he.
I am he.
And that I do nothing of myself.
I do nothing of myself.
But as my Father hath taught me.
Uh-oh. Look who he's crediting, the Spirit.
That's right.
As my Father. Now, dare to tell me he's crediting the second one.
No.
He's crediting the inner man.
That's it.
The Holy Ghost.
That's right.
The Father, God.
But as my Father hath taught me.
As my Father hath taught me.
I speak these things.
You see, the Spirit taught the flesh.
That's it.
On his own, the flesh did nothing or said nothing. Spirit is the teacher of the flesh.
That's right.
Like the Spirit is the teacher of the flesh today, the church.
Yeah.
Are you getting this?
Amen.
Oh, this is so beautifully outlined.
Oh, yes.
All right, go back to where you are real quick now.
Back in Galatians chapter 1.
My time is almost gone. Come on, son.
Back in Galatians 1 and verse 1.
Read fast.
Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man.
Yes.
But by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead.
Uh-huh.
And all the brethren which are with me unto the churches of Galatia.
Yes.
Grace be to you and peace from God the Father.
Yes.
And from our Lord Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh.
Who gave himself for our sins.
Yes.
That he might deliver us from this present evil world.
Yes.
According to the will of God and our Father.
You see, he died in the flesh according to the will of God and
our Father.
Now, wait a minute. And conjunction.
Right.
The will of God
and
our
Father.
What did he do? Die for two of them?
Amen.
The will of God and our Father.
And our Father.
Talking about two titles held by the one.
That's right.
All right, come on.
To whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
I marvel.
Uh-oh. I marvel
that you're so soon removed from him.
That's the problem.
That's the problem.
Amen. That you're so soon.
Removed from him.
Removed from him.
That called you into the grace of Christ.
Into the grace of
unto
Christ.
Unto another gospel. Which is not another.
Which is what?
Which is not another.
That's what I'm saying.
That's right.
That is not another gospel under the sun. Not
right.
Another.
Not another.
Not another.
Amen.
Amen. When I look at all these folk and where we travel around the world, I remember when it was just 12 to 15 meeting in a basement. Then from there, it went to Briar Road, then Frankfort Avenue. Amen. Then he put the broadcast, amen, on social media and on television. And before you know it, bottom fell out.
That's right.
Then took us to Lindley Avenue and took us around the world. Now I look at where this thing is falling. All through Africa, churches are popping up.
That's right.
Amen. I got a text message, I believe, 2 weeks ago. We sent one of the ministers, Bishop, out of Dubai, Bishop Benny, out of Mozambique, sent him, I believe it was, to Uganda. Botswana, I believe it was, baptized 158 in the name of Jesus Christ. Isn't that wonderful?
Wonderful.
Everything, just watching the program down there. God, that blessed us now. I don't have it with me. We have a local telecast coming right out of South Africa, covering Johannesburg, where we got a temple, Cape Town, where we got a temple, covering Malawi, Mozambique, going all the way up to Dubai, and covering all that. Amen. Going over towards the Sahara.
Wonderful.
Got Egypt, got Tanzania. Amen. Got Kenya, got Ethiopia. Glory to God.
Amen.
Amen. This is the Lord's doing. Wrote us from the United Arab Emirates. Amen. Contact us from Macedonia. We sent some brothers over to Macedonia, baptized Macedonians in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
They wrote us from Damascus and asked us, will you please come here to where Paul used to preach at?
Amen.
Amen. I'm looking to get into Damascus and hit creation. You know, God is opening up the door. Amen. He said, I'll make you fishers of men.
That's right.
Because we're so preoccupied doing the Lord's doing. That's why I just can't pay these nothings. No mind. They're yelling about some of these men try to make it like I'm so concerned about them. Pastor Jennings, he know he wants to call my name. No, I don't.
No, you don't. You really don't.
Man, I don't care if you eat a bowl of cornflakes with the roach wings in them. You know, years ago when I was little, they took cornflakes off the market, you know. They said because it was such a bad batch, they kept finding roach wings in them. Yeah, and then I guess somehow they fixed it. And the cornflakes is back. But I still don't trust them. Amen. So you viewers that want me to yell about your false prophet so bad, I'm after the big fish. I'm after the whale so I can harpoon them with Bible.
That's right.
Amen. You little goldfish and little
guppies, special.
Amen. Guppies and
guppies.
Tadpoles. Listen, I wouldn't care if you eat a bowl of Captain Crunch with Mikey Nikes. You really don't interest me. I was made a preacher.
Hallelujah.
And like Brother Hadley called me and left a message on my voicemail. He said, Pastor Jennings, I'm going to tell you from the depths of my heart, and I mean this. There's not, because I sent him the testimony of last week, how 256 were baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. He texted me back and said, wow. And then he called me back again and left a message. He said, let me say this to you, brother, from the depths of my heart. There's no one in America or the world that you even hear of whom God is dealing with today like he's dealing with you.
Amen.
Amen. You may not like us. You may call us arrogant and call us what you want. I don't care. You will never change what God is doing.
No.
Think of it. Heaven is using the truth of God to call the world back to holiness.
Hallelujah.
Heaven.
Hallelujah.
Is used in the world. He's used in the word, the truth word. Of God, to call the whole world back to holiness.
That's right.
Just like he used Noah and Methuselah to call creation to come into the ark.
That's right.
Amen. This thing is happening in our lifetime. Huh? Years ago, you had Bishop Johnson, and before him, you had Bishop R.C. Lawson. Before him, you had other bishops, way before our time, but I'm not responsible for them.
No.
Amen. They preach according to the light that God gave them. But I know right now why I'm the policeman walking the beat with the nightstick of the Bible in my hand. You will never change the fact that God is using the truth of God to call the attention of the whole world.
Right.
Think of that. Think now, of who that. Would not want to be a part of something like that?
Amen.
But a fool.
Amen.
Search the Bible. That's the way he used the apostles.
That's right.
He told them to go into all the world. And he didn't tell them to go there and don't show no results.
No.
That's right.
Oh, no.
Many men go somewhere and go there 2, 3, 4, or 5 times. You do good if they baptize 10 people in 20 years.
That's right. That's right.
Amen. We went to Pittsburgh. First time in Pittsburgh a few weeks ago. 150 went down in water. In the name of Jesus Christ. Been in New York many times, but I've never been to uptown Manhattan. We was there a few weeks ago. 192 went down in the water. This is God's doing. With the pine bush, dedicated the temple up there. 48 went down in the water. Amen. Greenville, Greenville. Everybody in Greenville.
Go ahead.
You might as well get ready to come out of the church you're in, and I don't care who your pastor is. The word of God says, repent.
Repent and be baptized.
Repent. Repent.
Repent. Thank you.
Let's explore the intricate and profound biblical narrative of the promise of Isaac, a central story found in the book of Genesis, primarily in chapters 17 through 22. This narrative unfolds against the backdrop of the covenant between God and Abraham, revealing themes of faith, obedience, and the miraculous fulfillment of divine promises. The saga begins with God establishing a covenant with Abraham when he was still known as Abram. God promised to make Abram the father of a multitude of nations and assured him that his descendants would be as numerous as the stars in the sky. This covenant marked a pivotal moment in biblical history, emphasizing God's divine plan for redemption through a chosen people. As the years passed, however, Abram and his wife Sarai, later renamed Abraham, and Sarah faced the challenge of infertility. Sarai, despite being barren, remained a key figure in God's plan. In an attempt to fulfill God's promise, Sarai suggested that Abram have a child with her maidservant, Hagar. Ishmael was born as a result of this union, but he was not the child through whom the covenant would be fulfilled. God, in an extraordinary display of grace, renewed the covenant with Abraham when he was 99 years old. God changed his name from Abram to Abraham, signifying his role as the father of many nations. Sarai's name was also changed to Sarah, and God promised that she would bear a son. Abraham, in awe of God's plan, fell on his face in humility and joy. The miraculous moment arrived when three angelic visitors, often understood to be a theophany or manifestation of God, appeared to Abraham and Sarah at the Oaks of Mamre. They reiterated the promise of a son to Sarah, who overheard the conversation from her tent. Sarah, initially skeptical due to her old age, laughed at the prospect of bearing a child. However, the visitors responded, "Is anything too hard for the Lord?" This phrase would echo through the narrative, emphasizing the omnipotence of God in fulfilling his promises. True to the divine promise, Sarah conceived and bore a son in her old age, just as God had foretold. The child was named Isaac, which means he laughs, a nod to Sarah's initial disbelief and the joy that now filled their lives. The birth of Isaac marked the fulfillment of the long-awaited promise, a testament to the faithfulness of God and the power of his word. As Isaac grew, tensions arose in the household. Sarah, perhaps driven by a mother's concern for her son's inheritance, requested that Abraham cast out Hagar and Ishmael. Despite his distress, Abraham received divine reassurance that God would also make a great nation of Ishmael, for he was also a son of Abraham. The narrative takes a dramatic turn when God tests Abraham's faith with a command that would pierce the very heart of the promise. God instructs Abraham to take Isaac, his beloved son, to the region of Moriah and offer him as a burnt offering. This divine command challenges the very core of Abraham's relationship with God, as Isaac was the promised child through whom the covenant was to be fulfilled. Abraham, driven by unwavering faith and obedience, rises early in the morning, takes Isaac, and embarks on the journey to Moriah. The symbolism of this journey echoes the biblical theme of testing and obedience, reminiscent of the Israelites' later journey through the wilderness. As they approach the designated place, Isaac innocently asks about the sacrificial lamb. Abraham, trusting in God's provision, responds that God will provide the lamb for the burnt offering. In a moment of profound faith, Abraham binds Isaac and lays him on the altar. Just as Abraham is about to sacrifice his son, the angel of the Lord intervenes, staying his hand. God, pleased with Abraham's unwavering obedience and trust, provides a ram caught in a thicket as a substitute sacrifice. The Lord reiterates his promise to bless Abraham and multiply his descendants. This moment becomes a pivotal event in biblical theology, foreshadowing God's ultimate sacrifice of his son, Jesus Christ, for the redemption of humanity. The promise of Isaac serves as a paradigmatic narrative within the broader biblical story, showcasing the interplay between faith, obedience, and the fulfillment of divine promises. Abraham's journey from the initial covenant through the birth of Isaac to the ultimate test of sacrificing his son encapsulates the human struggle to trust in God's providence, even in the face of seemingly insurmountable challenges. This narrative reverberates throughout the biblical text, influencing subsequent generations and becoming a foundational story in Judaism. Christianity, and Islam, it underscores the enduring theological themes of faith, obedience, and the faithfulness of God in fulfilling His promises, ultimately pointing toward the redemptive narrative that unfolds in the broader biblical context. The promise of Isaac remains a testament to the profound relationship between God and humanity, illustrating the transformative power of unwavering faith in the face of life's most challenging tests. Heavenly Father, Creator of the universe and source of all life, we approach your throne of grace with hearts overflowing with gratitude and awe. In the tapestry of existence, we see the threads of your love intricately woven, and we marvel at the beauty of your creation. Thank you for the precious gift of life and the manifold blessings that grace our days. We acknowledge with deep appreciation the love of family and friends, the warmth of human connection, and the simple joys that color our journey. In moments of celebration, we lift our voices in joyous praise, recognizing that every good and perfect gift comes from above. Yet, in our moments of trial and tribulation, we find solace in the knowledge that you are our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble. As we navigate the complexities of life, we lean on
As a Christian, it is crucial to delve into the history and character of Satan, our spiritual adversary. By understanding the origins, tactics, and ultimate defeat of the enemy, we can equip ourselves with knowledge and discernment to stand strong in our faith and resist his schemes. In this video, we will explore the biblical perspective on the history and character of Satan. The origins of Satan can be traced back to his initial creation as an angelic being. In Ezekiel 28:12-17 and Isaiah 14:12-15, we gain insights into his beginnings and subsequent fall. Satan, originally known as Lucifer, was created as a beautiful and powerful angel. However, pride and rebellion welled up in his heart, leading him to desire to exalt himself above God. As a result, he was cast out of heaven, along with a third of the angels who had joined him in his rebellion. Satan is depicted in the Bible as the deceiver and accuser. In John 8:44, Jesus refers to him as the father of lies, who seeks to deceive and manipulate humanity. Satan's primary objective is to lead people away from God and undermine his plans and purposes. He employs various tactics, such as temptation, doubt, and distortion of truth, in his relentless efforts to turn individuals away from the path of righteousness. Throughout history, we witness Satan's character through his interactions with humanity. In the Garden of Eden, he cunningly deceived Adam and Eve, enticing them to disobey God's command and introducing sin into the world. Satan's aim is to separate humanity from God, keeping them in bondage to sin and estranged from the abundant life found in Christ. Despite his power and influence, we find hope in the truth that Satan's ultimate defeat has been secured through Jesus Christ. Colossians 2:15 affirms that Jesus disarmed the powers and authorities, making a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Through his death and resurrection, Jesus broke the power of sin and defeated the works of the devil. As believers, we have the assurance that Satan's ultimate destiny is eternal separation from God in the lake of fire. Revelation 20:10. However, we must remain vigilant as Satan continues to wage spiritual warfare against believers. Ephesians 6:11-12 encourages us to put on the full armor of God to stand against the enemy's scheme. By cultivating a deep relationship with God, immersing ourselves in His Word, and relying on the power of the Holy Spirit, we can resist the devil and experience victory over his temptations and attacks. As Christians, we are called to be discerning, vigilant, and prayerful in our approach to spiritual warfare. We should not underestimate the enemy's tactics, but rather be aware of his strategies to deceive, discourage, and divide. By keeping our focus on Christ and relying on his strength, we can confidently navigate the challenges posed by Satan and emerge victorious. In conclusion, the history and character of Satan reveal him as a fallen angel who seeks to deceive and undermine God's plans. As believers, we must equip ourselves with biblical knowledge and discernment to recognize his tactics and resist his scheme. However, our hope lies in the victory secured by Jesus Christ through his death and resurrection. Let us stand firm in our faith, relying on God's strength and the spiritual armor he provides as we overcome the enemy and experience the abundant life found in Christ. As a Christian, it is essential to shed light on the deceptive tactics employed by Satan, the enemy of our souls. One of his strategies is to take symbols that have positive and sacred meanings, such as shapes, rainbows, and pyramids, and distort them, turning them into negative associations. In this article, we will explore how Satan seeks to manipulate the meaning of these symbols and how we can reclaim their true significance in light of God's Word. Symbols hold great power in human culture. They can convey deep meaning, evoke emotions, and serve as visual representations of abstract concepts. God, in his infinite wisdom, has used symbols throughout history to communicate his divine truths and promises to humanity. However, Satan, the father of lies, seeks to pervert and corrupt these symbols for his nefarious purposes. He cunningly takes symbols that hold positive meanings and distorts them, attaching negative connotations to deceive and confuse people. By doing so, he aims to undermine God's truth and lead individuals away from the path of righteousness. One symbol that Satan has distorted is the rainbow. In Genesis 9, verses 13 to 16, God established the rainbow as a sign of his covenant with humanity, promising never to flood the earth again. The rainbow represents God's faithfulness, love, and mercy. However, in recent times, the rainbow has been co-opted and associated with ideologies and movements that promote behaviors contrary to God's design for human relationships and sexuality. Satan has successfully manipulated this beautiful symbol to further his agenda, causing confusion and leading people astray. Another symbol that Satan has perverted is the pyramid. In biblical history, the pyramid shape was associated with the construction of monumental structures, such as the pyramids of Egypt, which served as tombs for ancient kings. However, in modern times, the pyramid has been used in various occult practices and conspiracy theories, linking it to secret societies and hidden agendas. Satan has exploited this symbol to foster fear and perpetuate false narratives, diverting attention from the true foundations of faith in God. Shapes, such as triangles and pentagrams, have also been subject to distortion. The triangle, which can symbolize the stability of God's love, has been twisted into occult symbols, representing demonic forces. Similarly, the pentagram, which historically had positive associations with the five wounds of Christ or the five senses, has been corrupted as a symbol of dark magic and witchcraft. As Christians, we must be vigilant and discerning. Recognizing these tactics employed by the enemy, we must not allow Satan to redefine the meaning of sacred symbols and distort our understanding of God's truth. Instead, we can reclaim these symbols by studying and embracing their original biblical significance. Moreover, it is crucial to rely on the guidance of the Holy Spirit and the truth of God's Word. The Bible is our ultimate source of wisdom and discernment. It reveals God's intentions and purposes for symbols, offering a solid foundation to navigate the intricate world of symbolism. In conclusion, Satan's attempt to distort symbols that have positive meanings is a cunning strategy to lead people astray and undermine the truths of God. As believers, we must be aware of these tactics and rely on biblical wisdom to discern the true meaning behind symbols. Let us reclaim these symbols, understanding their intended significance according to God's Word, and use them as reminders of His faithfulness, love, and redemption. By doing so, we can expose Satan's counterfeit and stand firm in the truth of Christ.
Let's explore the intricate and profound biblical narrative of the promise of Isaac, a central story found in the book of Genesis, primarily in chapters 17 through 22. This narrative unfolds against the backdrop of the covenant between God and Abraham, revealing themes of faith, obedience, and the miraculous fulfillment of divine promises. The saga begins with God establishing a covenant with Abraham when he was still known as Abram. God promised to make Abram the father of a multitude of nations and assured him that his descendants would be as numerous as the stars in the sky. This covenant marked a pivotal moment in biblical history, emphasizing God's divine plan for redemption through a chosen people. As the years passed, however, Abram and his wife Sarai, later renamed Abraham, and Sarah faced the challenge of infertility. Sarai, despite being barren, remained a key figure in God's plan. In an attempt to fulfill God's promise, Sarai suggested that Abram have a child with her maidservant, Hagar. Ishmael was born as a result of this union, but he was not the child through whom the covenant would be fulfilled. God, in an extraordinary display of grace, renewed the covenant with Abraham when he was 99 years old. God changed his name from Abram to Abraham, signifying his role as the father of many nations. Sarai's name was also changed to Sarah, and God promised that she would bear a son. Abraham, in awe of God's plan, fell on his face in humility and joy. The miraculous moment arrived when three angelic visitors, often understood to be a theophany or manifestation of God, appeared to Abraham and Sarah at the Oaks of Mamre. They reiterated the promise of a son to Sarah, who overheard the conversation from her tent. Sarah, initially skeptical due to her old age, laughed at the prospect of bearing a child. However, the visitors responded, "Is anything too hard for the Lord?" This phrase would echo through the narrative, emphasizing the omnipotence of God in fulfilling His promises. True to the divine promise, Sarah conceived and bore a son in her old age, just as God had foretold. The child was named Isaac, which means he laughs, a nod to Sarah's initial disbelief and the joy that now filled their lives. The birth of Isaac marked the fulfillment of the long-awaited promise, a testament to the faithfulness of God and the power of His Word. As Isaac grew, tensions arose in the household. Sarah, perhaps driven by a mother's concern for her son's inheritance, requested that Abraham cast out Hagar and Ishmael. Despite his distress, Abraham received divine reassurance that God would also make a great nation of Ishmael, for he was also a son of Abraham. The narrative takes a dramatic turn when God tests Abraham's faith with a command that would pierce the very heart of the promise. God instructs Abraham to take Isaac, his beloved son, to the region of Moriah and offer him as a burnt offering. This divine command challenges the very core of Abraham's relationship with God, as Isaac was the promised child through whom the covenant was to be fulfilled. Abraham, driven by unwavering faith and obedience, rises early in the morning, takes Isaac, and embarks on the journey to Moriah. The symbolism of this journey echoes the biblical theme of testing and obedience, reminiscent of the Israelites' later journey through the wilderness. As they approach the designated place, Isaac innocently asks about the sacrificial lamb. Abraham, trusting in God's provision, responds that God will provide the lamb for the burnt offering. In a moment of profound faith, Abraham binds Isaac and lays him on the altar. Just as Abraham is about to sacrifice his son, the angel of the Lord intervenes, staying his hand. God, pleased with Abraham's unwavering obedience and trust, provides a ram caught in a thicket as a substitute sacrifice. The Lord reiterates his promise to bless Abraham and multiply his descendants. This moment becomes a pivotal event in biblical theology, foreshadowing God's ultimate sacrifice of His Son, Jesus Christ, for the redemption of humanity. The promise of Isaac serves as a paradigmatic narrative within the broader biblical story, showcasing the interplay between faith, obedience, and the fulfillment of divine promises. Abraham's journey from the initial covenant through the birth of Isaac to the ultimate test of sacrificing his son encapsulates the human struggle to trust in God's providence, even in the face of seemingly insurmountable challenges. This narrative reverberates throughout the biblical text, influencing subsequent generations and becoming a foundational story in Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. It underscores the enduring theological themes of faith, obedience, and the faithfulness of God in fulfilling His promises, ultimately pointing toward the redemptive narrative that unfolds in the broader biblical context. The promise of Isaac remains a testament to the profound relationship between God and humanity, illustrating the transformative power of unwavering faith in the face of life's most challenging tests. Heavenly Father, as I enter into this sacred moment of communion with You, my heart is filled with reverence, gratitude, and an overwhelming sense of awe. You, O Lord, are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the Creator of the cosmos and the author of our destiny. I come before Your throne, acknowledging the magnitude of Your glory and the depth of Your love. I lift my eyes to the heavens, where Your majesty is proclaimed through the vastness of the universe. The stars and galaxies are but a glimpse of Your infinite creativity, and I am humbled by the thought that the same hands that formed the mountains and set the boundaries of the seas are the hands that hold my life. In the stillness of this moment, I pause to express my gratitude. Thank You, O God, for the gift of life, the intricate tapestry of breath, heartbeat, and consciousness. Every moment is a testimony to Your grace, a canvas upon which Your word declares in Psalm, "For You created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise You because I am fearfully and wonderfully made." Lord, I am thankful for the symphony of relationships in my life, for family whose bonds reflect the depth of Your love, for friends who are companions along this journey, for mentors who guide and shape my character. Each connection is a reflection of Your desire for community, and I thank You for the people You have strategically placed in my life. I bring before You the intricate details of my existence, the joys that light up my days, the challenges that refine my character, and the mundane moments that often go unnoticed. In this tapestry of experiences, I see Your hand at work, shaping, molding, and orchestrating a masterpiece that reveals Your redemptive love. In moments of solitude and reflection, I contemplate the depths of your word. Your scriptures are a wellspring of wisdom, a guide for my steps, and a source of comfort in times of trial. Open my eyes, O Lord, to the profound truths embedded in your word. May the lamp of your word illuminate the path ahead, and may your spirit be my constant guide. I recognize, O God, the brokenness of this world, the pain, injustice, and strife that often dominate our reality. I pray for the healing touch of your grace to permeate every corner of the earth. May your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In moments of despair, may the assurance of your sovereignty be a source of hope, and may your children be agents of change, reflecting your love and justice. In times of decision-making, I seek your divine guidance. Your word promises in Proverbs, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your paths straight. Direct my steps, O Lord, and align my desires with your perfect will. I lift up those who are burdened with illness, grief, or despair. Be their comfort, O God, and may your healing touch bring restoration and peace. Frame the promise in Isaiah for them. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Lord, I pray for the leaders of nations, communities, and families. Grant them wisdom, discernment, and a heart that seeks justice and mercy. May they lead with humility and a reverence for your guidance. Bring before you the needs of the marginalized, the oppressed, and those who cry out for justice. May the echoes of their voices reach the corridors of power, and may compassion prevail over indifference. In moments of doubt, remind me of your promises. Your word in Jeremiah assures me, for I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Strengthen my faith, O Lord, and help me to trust in your unfailing love, even when the path ahead seems uncertain. I confess my shortcomings before you, acknowledging the moments where I have fallen short of your glory. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Your word in 1 John assures me, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I receive your forgiveness with gratitude and seek the empowerment of your spirit to walk in righteousness. I lift up the desires of my heart, surrendering them to your sovereign will. In my aspirations and dreams, may your glory be the ultimate aim. Align the desires of my heart with your purposes, and may I find fulfillment in pursuing the plan. As I traverse the landscape of this day, may your presence be my constant companion. May I be aware of your nearness in every circumstance, finding solace in the shadow of your wings. I pray for divine appointments and opportunities to be a conduit of your love and grace. In moments of joy, may my heart overflow with gratitude. In moments of sorrow, may I find comfort in your embrace. In the ebb and flow of life seasons, may I be anchored in the unchanging truth of your word. This prayer, O Lord, is a fragrant offering, a symphony of words woven together with the threads of faith, hope, and love. As I conclude this extensive prayer, I do so with a spirit of surrender. I surrender my past, present, and future into your loving hands, trusting that your plans are good and your purposes are perfect. In the name of Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, I pray. Amen. mighty and everlasting God. In the quiet of this moment, I stand before your presence, humbled by your majesty and enveloped in your boundless love. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the source of all wisdom, grace, and mercy. I come before you with a heart overflowing with gratitude and reverence. I thank you, gracious Father, for the gift of life and the wondrous world you've created, the symphony of nature, the vibrant colors of the sky, the whisper of the winds, and the rhythm of life itself. Each is a testament to your infinite creativity and glory. Your word in Genesis 1:1 echoes in my spirit. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. I marvel at the beauty and intricacy of your creation. Lord, I thank you for the breath that fills my lungs, the beat of my heart, and the vitality that sustains me. Your divine design is evident in every fiber of my being, and I am grateful for the intricate masterpiece you've crafted, as the psalmist proclaims in Psalm. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Psalm 2:4, the warmth of the sun, the nourishment of the rain, and the abundance of the earth. Your provision is abundant, and I am grateful for the sustenance you provide. Physical, emotional, and spiritual, you are my Jehovah Jireh, my provider, and my sustainer. Gracious Father, I acknowledge the relationships you've woven into the fabric of my life. For family, friends, mentors, and acquaintances, each person is a precious reflection of your love, grace, and diversity. Thank you for the joy shared, the support offered, and the lessons learned through these cherished connections. I am grateful for the countless blessings you've bestowed upon me, the shelter that shields me, the nourishment that sustains me, and the opportunities that enrich my life. Your generosity knows no bounds, and I am continually amazed by your provision. As the Apostle James proclaims in James 1:17, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Lord, I lift up to you the challenges that I face, the obstacles that seem insurmountable, the uncertainties that cause anxiety, and the trials that test my faith. In these moments, I seek your guidance, strength, and peace that surpasses all. Your word assures me in Isaiah 40:10, do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I bring before you the dreams and aspirations nestled within the chambers of my heart. Grant me wisdom, discernment, and guidance as I navigate the pathways ahead. Your promise in Proverbs resonates in my spirit. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your path straight. Gracious Savior, I am profoundly thankful for your sacrificial love demonstrated on the cross. Your grace, mercy, and unending love are the foundation of my faith. Thank you for the forgiveness of sins, the redemption you offer, and the hope that anchors my soul, as the Apostle Paul declares in Ephesians. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. I am grateful for the moments of joy and laughter, the camaraderie of companionship, and the shared moments of celebration. Your word in Ecclesiastes reminds me there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to laugh. Father, I pray for the world around me, the brokenness that needs healing, the despair that needs hope, and the darkness that needs your light. May your peace, compassion, and love permeate every corner of this world, bringing restoration and reconciliation, as your word declares in Isaiah 61:1. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners. Lord, I lift up my hopes, fears, and uncertainties, surrendering them into your loving care. Your plans for me are good, and your purposes are perfect. Help me to trust in your timing and rest in your provision. As Jeremiah assures me, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Heavenly Father, I pray for a heart that is quick to forgive, a spirit that reflects your compassion, and a life that mirrors your love. May my actions, words, and thoughts be a testament to your grace and truth. In Ephesians, your word instructs us, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. in moments of decision-making and uncertainty, grant me clarity and wisdom. May your word be a lamp to my feet and a light to my path, illuminating the way forward. Your promise in James gives me assurance. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Father, I confess my shortcomings and inadequacies, seeking your forgiveness and your transforming grace. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Your word in Psalm speaks to my soul. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Lord, I pray for a heart that overflows with gratitude, a gratitude that transcends circumstances and acknowledges your presence in every season of life. May thankfulness be the melody of my life, a constant reminder of your goodness and faithfulness. As I look towards the future, I place my trust in you. May your will be done in my life, and may your name be glorified in all that I do. Your promise in Philippians resonates in my spirit. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the privilege of approaching your throne in prayer. I conclude this prayer with a heart surrendered to your will, a spirit receptive to your guidance, and a soul anchored in the hope found in Christ Jesus. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Prayer 1. Rai. O Heavenly Father, Creator of all things, I come before you with a humble heart, seeking your guidance and wisdom. In your infinite mercy, pour out your grace upon me, that I may walk in your ways and live according to your will. Grant me strength to resist temptation and courage to face challenges. May your love be the light that guides my path, and your peace be the comfort in my soul. Let your Holy Spirit dwell within me, guiding my thoughts, words, and actions. Help me to be a vessel of your love and compassion, sharing your message of hope with all I encounter. In your name, I pray, Amen.
Prayer 2. Lord Jesus, Savior of the world, I lift my voice to you in praise and adoration. You who sacrificed yourself for the redemption of humanity, I thank you for your boundless love and mercy. Grant me the grace to forgive as you have forgiven, and to love as you have loved. Fill my heart with your compassion, that I may see others through your eyes and extend a hand of kindness to those in need. Guide me in the paths of righteousness, that I may bring glory to your name in all that I do. Let your peace reign in my life, casting out all fear and doubt. Bless me with the courage to proclaim your gospel boldly, that others may come to know the salvation you offer. In your precious name, Amen.
Prayer 3. Holy Spirit, Divine Comforter, I welcome your presence into my life today. Fill me with your gifts of wisdom, understanding, counsel, and fortitude, that I may discern your will and follow it faithfully. Grant me the grace to be patient in times of trial and steadfast in times of temptation. Help me to surrender my will to yours, trusting in your plan for my life. Kindle in me the fire of your love, that I may be a witness to your truth in a world filled with darkness. Strengthen my faith, that I may not waver in times of uncertainty, but stand firm in the knowledge of your unfailing love. May your peace, which surpasses all understanding, guard my heart and mind in Christ Jesus. I pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Prayer 4. Gracious God, source of all goodness and mercy, I come before you with a heart overflowing with gratitude. Thank you for the blessings you have bestowed upon me, both seen and unseen. Help me to never take your gifts for granted, but to always recognize your hand at work in my life. Grant me the humility to acknowledge my dependence on you and the generosity to share your blessings with others. Lead me in paths of righteousness, that I may honor you with my thoughts, words, and deeds. Heal me of any wounds or hurts that hinder my relationship with you and with others. May your grace abound in me, transforming me into a reflection of your love and grace. In your holy name I pray, Amen.
Prayer 5. Heavenly Father, Divine Physician, I lift up to you all those who are suffering in mind, body, or spirit. Bring comfort to the brokenhearted, healing to the sick, and peace to the troubled. Let your love surround them like a warm embrace, reassuring them of your presence in their midst. Grant wisdom to those who care for the sick and strength to those who advocate for the marginalized. May your healing touch bring wholeness and restoration to those in need. Help us to be instruments of your peace and channels of your healing grace in a world that so desperately needs it. Give us hearts of compassion and hands ready to serve, that we may be your hands and feet in the world. In Jesus' name we pray, Amen.
Prayer 6. Lord God, Almighty and Everlasting, I come before you with a heart full of praise and thanksgiving. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end and the end, and in you, all things hold together. Grant me the strength to persevere in faith, even when the storms of life rage around me. Help me to trust in your promises, knowing that you are faithful to fulfill them. Give me the courage to step out in obedience, even when the path is unclear. Let your light shine through me, illuminating the darkness and pointing others to you. Bless me with discernment, that I may recognize your voice amidst the noise of the world. May your will be done in my life, on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' precious name, Amen.
Prayer 7. Loving Father, Prince of Peace, I come before you with a heart burdened by the brokenness of the world. Hear the cries of your people and have mercy on us, O Lord. Bring an end to violence and injustice and usher in your kingdom of peace and righteousness. Give wisdom to our leaders that they may govern with integrity and compassion. Comfort those who mourn, heal the sick, and provide for the needy. Help us to be agents of reconciliation and instruments of your peace in a world torn apart by division and strife. Renew in us a spirit of hope that we may work tirelessly for the coming of your kingdom. Let your love reign in our hearts, casting out all fear and hatred. In the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace, we pray, Amen.
Heavenly Father, we come before you today with hearts filled with gratitude and a deep desire to draw closer to you, seeking to live a life that reflects the love, grace, and compassion of your Son, Jesus Christ. We gather as a community of believers united and are yearning to emulate his teachings, his character, and his selfless love. Lord, we know that at times the path to living a life like Jesus can seem challenging, even impossible, but we are reminded of the words of your son in Matthew 19:26, where he declared, "With man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible." These words, O Lord, inspire and reassure us that through your divine guidance and strength, it is indeed possible to live a life that mirrors the example set by Jesus Christ. Today, we come before you, lifting up those among us who may be struggling on this journey, feeling inadequate, alone, or on the verge of giving up. Help us, dear Lord, to grasp the depth of your love as demonstrated through your Son, Jesus Christ. May we learn from his humility, his compassion for the marginalized, his willingness to forgive, and his unwavering commitment to your will. Lord, let us not be disheartened by our imperfections, but rather let them be stepping stones on our path to transformation. We pray for unity among your people, that we may be a source of support and encouragement to one another in our pursuit of a Christ-like life. May we love one another as Christ loved us selflessly and sacrificially, and may our lives be living testimonies of your grace and love. Lord, in moments when we doubt our ability to follow in Jesus' footsteps, remind us that your grace is sufficient and your power is made perfect in our weakness. 12:9. When we feel alone, remind us of your promise to never leave us nor forsake us. 13:5. In times when we're tempted to give up, grant us the strength to press on, knowing that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. We thank you, Lord, for the hope and possibility of transformation that you offer through faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. May we continue to seek his guidance, rely on his strength, and reflect his love to a world in need. We come before you today with humble hearts, seeking your guidance, strength, and grace. We gather as a community of believers, inspired by the desire to live a life that reflects the love, compassion, and selflessness of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we know that emulating Jesus may seem like an impossible task at times, but we also know that with you, all things are possible. Your word reminds us in Philippians 2:5, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. These words, Lord, speak to the incredible humility and selflessness of Jesus, and they serve as a beacon of hope, showing us that we too can strive to live in such a way. Today, we lift up to you those who are earnestly seeking to live a life like Jesus Christ, but may feel overwhelmed by the challenges that lie ahead. Lord, they may be grappling with their own shortcomings, the temptations of this world, or the weight of past mistakes. We ask for your guidance to lead them, your strength to uphold them, and your forgiveness to cleanse them. Help us, O Lord, to continually fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. May we learn from his love for the marginalized, his compassion for the hurting, and his unwavering commitment to your will. Lord, in moments of doubt and weakness, may we remember that your grace is sufficient for us and your power is made perfect in our weakness. We pray for unity among your people, that we may support one another in our journey to become more like Christ. May we be a community of believers who lift each other up, who bear one another's burdens, and who love as Jesus loved. Lord, as we strive to live like your Son, grant us wisdom, discernment, and a heart that is quick to forgive. Fill us with the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Let these fruits overflow from our lives, touching the lives of those we encounter. In our moments of weakness and despair, remind us that your love is unchanging, your promises are sure, and your presence is with us always. Your word declares that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, and we cling to this truth as we seek to live like him. We thank you, Lord, for the possibility of transformation and for the example of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we walk in his footsteps, shine his light, and share his love with the world. We offer this prayer in his holy and precious name. Amen.
Thank you.
Dear Heavenly Father, as the first rays of dawn gently touch the earth, we come before you with hearts full of gratitude and reverence. We thank you, dear Lord, for granting us the gift of a brand new day. Your mercies are new every morning, and we are in awe of your endless love and compassion. As we embark on this day, we seek your guidance and strength. Lord, we acknowledge that without you, we are nothing. You are the source of all wisdom, and we ask for your wisdom to guide our thoughts and decisions throughout this day. Grant us discernment, that we may make choices that align with your will and bring honor to your name. Help us to let go of any burdens or worries that may weigh us down. Remind us that you are our refuge and strength and ever-present help in times of trouble. May we cast all our anxieties upon you, knowing that you care for us and will sustain us through every challenge we face. Father, we pray for protection today. Shield us from harm, both seen and unseen. Surround us with your heavenly angels, that we may walk in your divine protection and experience your peace that surpasses all understanding. Lord, as we interact with others today, may we be vessels of your love and grace. Help us to be patient and kind, understanding and forgiving. May our words be filled with encouragement and our actions be guided by compassion. Let us be instruments of reconciliation and unity, promoting harmony among those we encounter. In the midst of our busy lives, we sometimes forget to pause and thank you for the simple blessings. Today, we take a moment to acknowledge the beauty of creation, the vibrant colors of the flowers, the melody of the birds, and the gentle whisper of the breeze, Your handiwork surrounds us, and we are in awe of your creative power. Lord, grant us a heart of gratitude that we may appreciate the abundance that you have provided for us. May we be content with what we have, and generous in sharing with those in need. Open our eyes to the opportunities to be a blessing to others, and may our actions reflect the generosity of your heart. As we step into the day's tasks and responsibilities, may we be diligent in our work, giving our best efforts in everything we do. May our work be a reflection of your excellence and a testimony of your goodness. For those facing challenges and uncertainties, we lift them up to you, Lord. You are the great comforter, and we ask that you wrap your love and arms around those who are hurting, bring healing to the sick, comfort to the grieving, and hope to the discouraged. In the busyness of life, may we never lose sight of your presence. May we continuously commune with you in prayer, seeking your guidance and sharing our joys and sorrows. Help us to cultivate a deep and personal relationship with you, knowing that in you, we find true fulfillment and purpose. Before we close this prayer, Lord, we want to express our love for you. You loved us first, and your love knows no bounds. May our lives be a testament of our love for you as we strive to walk in obedience to your will. Thank you, dear Lord, for hearing our prayer. We commit this day into your hands, trusting that you will lead us and guide us in all we do. May your name be glorified through our words, actions, and attitudes. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. As a Christian, it is important to approach sensitive topics with wisdom and grace. While comparing politicians to Satan might seem provocative, it is essential to explore the influences, choices, and impact of political leaders in light of spiritual principles. In this video, we will engage in a reflective discussion, aiming to draw parallels that help us better understand the challenges faced by politicians and the importance of holding them accountable. 1. The temptation of power. Satan is known for his desire for power and authority as evidenced by his attempt to exalt himself above God. Isaiah 14, verses 12 to 14. Similarly, political leaders often find themselves faced with the allure of power. The pursuit of political influence and control can be tempting, leading some to compromise their values and exploit their positions for personal gain. 2. Deception and manipulation. Satan is the ultimate deceiver, employing cunning strategies to deceive and manipulate. In the political realm, we occasionally witness instances of deception and manipulation as politicians seek to sway public opinion, gain support, or advance their agendas. It is crucial for believers to exercise discernment, carefully evaluating the integrity and motives of political leaders. 3. moral dilemmas and ethical choices. Satan often presents individuals with moral dilemmas, enticing them to compromise their values and principles. In politics, leaders face challenging decisions that require navigating complex ethical landscapes. The pressure to compromise or make choices that contradict biblical principles can be overwhelming. Christian voters should evaluate the moral character and positions of politicians, supporting leaders who align with God's truth. 4. Division and strife. Satan thrives on sowing discord and fostering division. Unfortunately, political landscapes can be marked by polarization, ideological battles, and divisive rhetorics. As Christians, we are called to promote unity and pursue peace. Romans 12:18. We should be wary of political leaders who fuel division rather than fostering dialogue and understanding. 5. Accountability and integrity. Satan avoids accountability and operates in darkness. In politics, the importance of holding leaders accountable cannot be overstated. Believers should actively participate in the political process, engaging in constructive dialogue and demanding transparency and integrity from elected officials. We have a responsibility to support leaders who demonstrate moral character and a commitment to serving the common good. While it may be thought-provoking to compare politicians to Satan, the intention is not to vilify individuals, but to acknowledge the challenges they face and emphasize the need for accountability. Just as Satan tempts and deceives, political leaders can be vulnerable to similar pitfalls. However, it is important to remember that not all politicians succumb to these temptations. Many are dedicated public servants striving to make positive changes within their communities. As Christians, we are called to engage in the political sphere with discernment, guided by biblical principles. Let us pray for our political leaders, that they may seek wisdom, act with integrity, and be open to the leading of the Holy Spirit. May we also exercise our responsibility as citizens to participate actively, promote righteousness, and hold leaders accountable. Ultimately, by shining the light of God's truth, we can contribute to a more just and compassionate society. Examining church traditions, discerning the non-biblical practices, as a pastor, it is crucial for us to continuously evaluate and re-examine the practices and traditions within our churches. While traditions can foster unity and provide a sense of continuity, it is important to ensure that they align with the biblical teachings we hold dear. In this video, we will delve into some church traditions that, upon careful scrutiny, may be found to lack clear biblical support. By engaging in this introspective exercise, we aim to promote a more authentic expression of our faith and foster a deeper understanding of God's Word. 1. Ornate rituals and ceremonies. Many churches have developed elaborate rituals and ceremonies that are often performed with great pomp and splendor. While aesthetics and symbolism can enhance worship experiences, it is essential to remember that God is primarily concerned with the condition of our hearts rather than the grandeur of our rituals. 1 Samuel 16, verse 7. When the focus shifts from genuine worship to external displays, we risk losing sight of the core message of Christ. 2. Superfluous sacramental requirements. Some traditions have added extra requirements or conditions to the biblical sacraments, such as baptism or communions. These additional regulations can unintentionally place burdens on believers and detract from the essential message of grace found in the Scriptures. It is important to emphasize the simplicity and inclusivity of the gospel, which extends God's love and salvation freely to all who believe. Ephesians 2 verses 8 and 9. 3. Excessive clerical hierarchy. While church leadership is crucial for guidance and pastoral care, excessive emphasis on hierarchical structures can create an unhealthy divide between clergy and laity. The Bible teaches that all believers are part of the royal priesthood. 1 Peter 2 verse 9, called to serve and minister to one another. Cultivating a culture of collaboration and shared responsibility fosters a vibrant and engaged church community. 4. Overemphasis on material prosperity. In certain traditions, there is an overemphasis on material wealth and prosperity as a sign of God's favor. While God does bless individuals in various ways, it is important to avoid equating prosperity with spiritual maturity or godliness. The Bible teaches us to seek first God's kingdom and righteousness. Matthew 6, verse 33. Emphasizing the eternal treasures of a transformed heart and a deep relationship with God. 5. Legalistic observance of traditions. In some cases, traditions become deeply ingrained and rigidly enforced, leading to legalism. When adherence to customs and regulations takes precedence over the principles of love, mercy, and justice, the essence of the gospel is compromised. Matthew 23, verses 20, 3 verses 23 and 24. A faith rooted in love and freedom encourages genuine relationship with God and authentic connections with others. While traditions can provide a sense of identity and cultural cohesion within our churches, it is vital to evaluate them in light of biblical teachings. By critically examining our practices and traditions, we can ensure that they do not inadvertently detract from the central message of the gospel. Let us embrace a spirit of humility and openness to God's leading, aligning our traditions with the timeless truths of Scripture. In doing so, we can cultivate a vibrant and authentic church that reflects the transformative power of God's Word and love. Heavenly Father, in the depths of our hearts, we come before you with a humble spirit, seeking purity of heart and mind. You are the one who knows us intimately, who sees every hidden thought and desire within us. We acknowledge that we are not perfect, and our hearts can be easily led astray by the temptations of this world. But today, we lay our hearts bare before you, longing for your cleansing touch and the renewal of our minds. Lord, we recognize that purity of heart and mind is not something we can achieve on our own. It is a gift from you, a work of your grace within us. We ask that you create in us clean hearts, hearts that are free from impurity and corruption. Wash away all the stains of sin and purify us from all unrighteousness. Forgive us, O Lord, for the times we have allowed impure thoughts and desires to take root in our minds. We confess our shortcomings and weaknesses, knowing that you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Help us to turn away from anything that defiles our hearts and leads us away from your perfect will. As we seek purity of heart and mind, we also pray for discernment. In a world filled with distractions and temptations, help us to recognize what is good and pleasing in your sight. Open our eyes to see the truth and protect us from the deceitfulness of sin. Fill our minds with thoughts that are pure, lovely, and praiseworthy. May we meditate on your word day and night, that it may be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Let the truth of your word take root in our hearts, shaping our thoughts and guiding our action. Lord, we know that our hearts are the wellspring of life, and what is in our hearts will ultimately manifest in our words and deeds. Therefore, we ask that you transform our hearts so that they reflect the beauty of your holiness. May our words be uplifting and encouraging, spreading love and hope to those around us. We pray for purity in our relationships, both with ourselves and with others. Guard our hearts from bitterness, envy, and jealousy. Help us to treat others with respect and kindness, valuing them as fellow children of God. Teach us to love our neighbors as ourselves and to seek reconciliation when conflicts arise. Above all, Lord, we desire to have a heart that is wholly devoted to you. May we love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. May our lives be living testimonies of your transforming power, drawing others closer to you through our words and action. In our pursuit of purity of heart and mind, we know that we will face challenges and setbacks, but we take comfort in the knowledge that you are with us every step of the way. Your grace is sufficient for us, and your power is made perfect in our weakness. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your love and faithfulness. We commit ourselves to you, trusting that you will lead us on the path of righteousness and purity. May our lives bring glory and honor to your name. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray.
Heavenly Father, creator of the universe and source of all life, we approach your throne of grace with hearts overflowing with gratitude and awe. In the tapestry of existence, we see the threads of your love intricately woven, and we marvel at the beauty of your creation. Thank you for the precious gift of life and the manifold blessings that grace our days. We acknowledge with deep appreciation the love of family and friends, the warmth of human connection, and the simple joys that color our journey. In moments of celebration, we lift our voices in joyous praise, recognizing that every good and perfect gift comes from above. Yet in our moments of trial and tribulation, we find solace in the knowledge that you are our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble. As we navigate the complexities of life, we lean on your wisdom, seeking your guidance in every decision and action. Grant us discernment to distinguish your voice amid the noise of the world, and the courage to follow where you lead. Where prayer extends beyond the borders of our individual lives to encompass the collective well-being of humanity. In a world marked by diversity, may your love unite us, transcending barriers of nationality, ethnicity, and creed. We pray for peace to reign in every corner of the globe, for justice to prevail, and for the downtrodden to find relief. We lift up those who are suffering, the sick, the lonely, the oppressed, and the marginalized. May your healing touch bring comfort, and may our hands be extended in compassion to those in need. In times of despair, may the light of your love pierce through the darkness, offering hope and restoration. As we intercede for our leaders, grant them wisdom and humility. May they govern with justice and integrity, seeking the well-being of all citizens. Guide them in the pursuit of policies that promote equality, protect the vulnerable, and foster a world where righteousness and peace kiss. In our personal relationships, grant us the strength to forgive as we have been forgiven, to love as we have been loved. May our interactions be characterized by grace, kindness, and understanding. Help us mend broken relationships and be agents of reconciliation in a world.
As a Christian, it is crucial to delve into the history and character of Satan, our spiritual adversary. By understanding the origins, tactics, and ultimate defeat of the enemy, we can equip ourselves with knowledge and discernment to stand strong in our faith and resist his schemes. In this video, we will explore the biblical perspective on the history and character of Satan. The origins of Satan can be traced back to his initial creation as an angelic being. In Ezekiel 28:12-17 and Isaiah 14:12-15, we gain insights into his beginnings and subsequent fall. Satan, originally known as Lucifer, was created as a beautiful and powerful angel. However, pride and rebellion welled up in his heart, leading him to desire to exalt himself above God. As a result, he was cast out of heaven, along with a third of the angels who had joined him in his rebellion. Satan is depicted in the Bible as the deceiver and accuser. In John 8:44, Jesus refers to him as the father of lies, who seeks to deceive and manipulate humanity. Satan's primary objective is to lead people away from God and undermine his plans and purposes. He employs various tactics, such as temptation, doubt, and distortion of truth, in his relentless efforts to turn individuals away from the path of righteousness. Throughout history, we witness Satan's character through his interactions with humanity. In the Garden of Eden, he cunningly deceived Adam and Eve, enticing them to disobey God's command and introducing sin into the world. Satan's aim is to separate humanity from God, keeping them in bondage to sin and estranged from the abundant life found in Christ. Despite his power and influence, we find hope in the truth that Satan's ultimate defeat has been secured through Jesus Christ. Colossians 2:15 affirms that Jesus disarmed the powers and authorities, making a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Through his death and resurrection, Jesus broke the power of sin and defeated the works of the devil. As believers, we have the assurance that Satan's ultimate destiny is eternal separation from God in the lake of fire. Revelation 20:10. However, we must remain vigilant as Satan continues to wage spiritual warfare against believers. Ephesians 6:11-12 encourages us to put on the full armor of God to stand against the enemy's scheme. By cultivating a deep relationship with God, immersing ourselves in His Word, and relying on the power of the Holy Spirit, we can resist the devil and experience victory over his temptations and attacks. As Christians, we are called to be discerning, vigilant, and prayerful in our approach to spiritual warfare. We should not underestimate the enemy's tactics, but rather be aware of his strategies to deceive, discourage, and divide. By keeping our focus on Christ and relying on his strength, we can confidently navigate the challenges posed by Satan and emerge victorious. In conclusion, the history and character of Satan reveal him as a fallen angel who seeks to deceive and undermine God's plans. As believers, we must equip ourselves with biblical knowledge and discernment to recognize his tactics and resist his scheme. However, our hope lies in the victory secured by Jesus Christ through his death and resurrection. Let us stand firm in our faith, relying on God's strength and the spiritual armor he provides as we overcome the enemy and experience the abundant life found in Christ. As a Christian, it is essential to shed light on the deceptive tactics employed by Satan, the enemy of our souls. One of his strategies is to take symbols that have positive and sacred meanings, such as shapes, rainbows, and pyramids, and distort them, turning them into negative associations. In this article, we will explore how Satan seeks to manipulate the meaning of these symbols and how we can reclaim their true significance in light of God's Word. Symbols hold great power in human culture. They can convey deep meaning, evoke emotions, and serve as visual representations of abstract concepts. God, in his infinite wisdom, has used symbols throughout history to communicate his divine truths and promises to humanity. However, Satan, the father of lies, seeks to pervert and corrupt these symbols for his nefarious purposes. He cunningly takes symbols that hold positive meanings and distorts them, attaching negative connotations to deceive and confuse people. By doing so, he aims to undermine God's truth and lead individuals away from the path of righteousness. One symbol that Satan has distorted is the rainbow. In Genesis 9, verses 13 to 16, God established the rainbow as a sign of his covenant with humanity, promising never to flood the earth again. The rainbow represents God's faithfulness, love, and mercy. However, in recent times, the rainbow has been co-opted and associated with ideologies and movements that promote behaviors contrary to God's design for human relationships and sexuality. Satan has successfully manipulated this beautiful symbol to further his agenda, causing confusion and leading people astray. Another symbol that Satan has perverted is the pyramid. In biblical history, the pyramid shape was associated with the construction of monumental structures, such as the pyramids of Egypt, which served as tombs for ancient kings. However, in modern times, the pyramid has been used in various occult practices and conspiracy theories, linking it to secret societies and hidden agendas. Satan has exploited this symbol to foster fear and perpetuate false narratives, diverting attention from the true foundations of faith in God. Shapes, such as triangles and pentagrams, have also been subject to distortion. The triangle, which can symbolize the stability of God's love, has been twisted into occult symbols, representing demonic forces. Similarly, the pentagram, which historically had positive associations with the five wounds of Christ or the five senses, has been corrupted as a symbol of dark magic and witchcraft. As Christians, we must be vigilant and discerning. Recognizing these tactics employed by the enemy, we must not allow Satan to redefine the meaning of sacred symbols and distort our understanding of God's truth. Instead, we can reclaim these symbols by studying and embracing their original biblical significance. Moreover, it is crucial to rely on the guidance of the Holy Spirit and the truth of God's Word. The Bible is our ultimate source of wisdom and discernment. It reveals God's intentions and purposes for symbols, offering a solid foundation to navigate the intricate world of symbolism. In conclusion, Satan's attempt to distort symbols that have positive meanings is a cunning strategy to lead people astray and undermine the truths of God. As believers, we must be aware of these tactics and rely on biblical wisdom to discern the true meaning behind symbols. Let us reclaim these symbols, understanding their intended significance according to God's Word, and use them as reminders of His faithfulness, love, and redemption. By doing so, we can expose Satan's counterfeit and stand firm in the truth of Christ,